Here is how government corruption works in Nova Scotia. September 21, 2010, my attempted murder update, written by Daniel J. Towsey, a truth soldier. I am writing this to update my online readers as to my situation pertaining to the recent serious attempt on my life, where they deliberately drove a car over me while I was riding my bicycle. I know for sure that I get over 1 million readers a year that have been reading my many articles of truth I have written and published online over the past 11 years. If you have been able to read my articles pertaining to my personal life, you would be well aware as to what government corruption I and many others have been victims of. As you may know, there was another attempt on my life November 22, 2009. Where at least 4 conspirators staged a vehicle accident to look like I was run over while walking across a crosswalk. Unfortunately for them, I survived. So I felt it absolutely necessary to publish the details of this event online. You can read my article entitled, How to Assassinate a Cyclist, to get the details of the accident. You may also read My Promise to God, to get an understanding of the depth of my thinking and some of the events I have been a victim of at the hands of those in authority. Then I encourage you to read my latest article entitled, Halifax, Nova Scotia's Connection to 911. Previously I wrote 2 other related articles entitled, Cyclist Danger Zone Sign Proposal, and, With the Undersigned Letter of Understanding Petition, before this latest attempt on my life. I had been reduced from being self-employed and having a house, a car, a business, a cube oven, a trailer, and a mountain bike. I had several businesses, such as Towsey's Welding and Auto Repairs, where the police were involved in their second break-in and robbery of my businesses, where I lost up to $180,000 in tools and equipment when they drove a cube van in my shop and cleared it. While witnesses were calling the police and the police would not respond to the emergency call. Instead, they stayed parked nearby and intercepted the radio police calls telling the dispatcher everything was all right. I know this because I had several neighbors tell me what had happened. If you read my articles about my participation in a federal election back in 1984 in North York, Toronto, where Bob Kaplan, the then Solicitor General of Canada, created Canada's secret police seize. Eyes. Canadian Secret Intelligence Service, 6 months into the election campaign, and that he issued a contract on my life. These were his words. We will destroy you, we will make you so destitute that you will have to resort to crime to survive, and when you do, we will put you in jail where we will have our fun with you. You will get a very good idea after you read my Corrupt Canadian Elections article as to what has been going on and why I took the only option I had left to me, and that was to go online and start researching, writing and publishing about these events. Over the years I have done a lot of research and published a lot of articles about who these conspirators are and why they were rigging our elections. The research I have done has opened up a whole world of corruption, and I have learned exactly who, what, where, when and how this has come to be what is termed as the New World Order and their plans to control the world through their ability to create money out of thin air. As they have said, if they control the manufacture of the people's money over time, they will be able to achieve their insane plans of controlling the world as the money controls everything. You can read my article, Creation of First Corporation, Worst Crime in Human History, to see how this has been made possible, and learn about their 100-year plan that comes to an end at the end of On Deck 21-2012. The Fed was penned in 1912, not 1913. Then I recommend you read my very controversial article about what these secret society controllers have been responsible for. Read, Are You Ready for the Truth? One more thing. I have written many articles as to the situation in Canada and what this country was about before the conspirators started rigging our Canadian elections and what we have become. I recommend you read Beware of the Corporate Mind first, then read The Last Democracy. The Last Democracy is Dead. Once upon a time there was a Canada. The House of Commons, and my visits to Ottawa's Parliament. I assure you that after you read all these, you will definitely know and see what the web of deceit has woven into the very fabric of society. I pray that you will wake up and realize that we all have to bring truth back to the forefront of society, or we will never again have justice or liberty. That is what my fight for survival has been all about. It has been about the survival of this planet and all of us. I pray that everyone soon wakes up and realize that we are all going to be doomed if our future is not guided by truth. The money masters are completely insane, for they seek no truth and speak no truth. Now I will update my readers as to my dreadful situation and what condition my health is in as a result of the recent attempted murder of me. It will take some time for me to write this as articulately and accurately simple as I can. My only hope in writing this is that somewhere someone will realize that if I perish, that so will the truths that I have so carefully researched and written about. So you had better stop assuming that I am delusional. You had better do some thinking for yourselves and read my articles of truth in full. Stop using psychiatric terms to explain things. First of all, psychiatry is not a science. It is just an art of deception and destruction. If you read my article, Psychiatry and Industry of Death, and then, Who is Delusional Now, you will be smarter than any quack you ever meet. I have written all my articles in very simple English, and most of my articles have numerous links to articles that you can check out to verify my truth soldier writings. So again, I plead with you, my readers, to join me in this revolution of truth and become a truth soldier now. A truth soldier is only armed with the knowledge of the forbidden truths, as I wrote in my recent article entitled, The Huge Learning Curve to the Forbidden Truths, for when the seeds of truth are sown, the grassroots truth revolution will blossom from the enlightenment. Sorry for getting off topic about my situation and the government corruption here. I will soon be uploading all my medical records and any other confidential records I have, because I am fighting for my survival. To this site, http://ca.groups.yahoo.com/group/thetruthsoldierspersonalarchives/. I needed to see all my medical records, as they need to be made public, because the government here is not based on truth, justice, and liberty. Instead, it has a history of covert Freemason corruption to serve only those that are secret members. I live in a relatively small community in Dartmouth, Nova Scotia, next to the city of Halifax. 80% of the people in this province of Nova Scotia, with an estimated population of 800,000, derive their income from the government. This has created a very spoiled society that has no reason to care for or fight for truth. They have all been bought off. I would love them proving me wrong. Nova Scotia receives what are called transfer payments, handouts, from the federal government at the cost of the more productive peoples of other provinces. That is the main reason why the French province of Quebec has repeatedly tried to separate from Canada. If you read my Corrupt Canadian Elections article, you might understand why Quebecers believe the votes were rigged, and that the people of Quebec have successfully voted to separate. I am doing all this extra off-topic writing to give you, my readers, a good understanding as to why the local authorities are doing everything they can to silence me and have tried repeatedly to kill me. Since my accident, I have been left with numerous serious injuries. I can barely walk with a walker. I walk very slowly. I have no social life. I spend my days in prison in my home. The doctors have refused to give me any aid of any kind. That is very easy to happen, as this place has a public health care system run and controlled by a very few shadowy figures. Government officials here and in this country really believe that they are gods and that they can do anything they want to anyone at any time. We part of that is very true, as the common people here have been completely enslaved to the corporations. Once you understand that since NAFTA and free trade, all our governments are now corporations that are staffed with people with a corporate mind. All this takeover of our societies has been achieved through social engineering and the corporate medias. Since I have been deliberately injured, I have repeatedly tried to see doctors about my broken back. I have done physiotherapy at Maritime Physiotherapy twice a week for the past 10 months. I now have a very good understanding as to my injuries and my disabilities. I have so many skeletal and internal injuries that I cannot write all that here and now. I have two injuries to my spine at my lower neck. I have a completely severed T8 fracture. The T8 fracture is dislocated and not in line. I discovered this when I had a message therapist do an exploratory on me. I also have many atrophied, dead, muscles around my torso, in particular to my right shoulder area, as my right arm from the elbow up and right shoulder were crushed. My right upper arm now has a plastic prosthesis, bone, and joint. My right shoulder blade is so damaged that the prosthesis cannot sit in the socket of my shoulder blade, leaving me with next to no use of my right upper arm. I also lost my large intestine, leaving me with serious digestion and nutritional difficulties. I have great difficulties in getting sleep. I have a hospital bed and I very often cannot sleep due to pain and intestinal difficulties. I am writing just a few of the details of some of my injuries so you, the reader, will understand that my injuries are very real. My broken back makes walking very painful and difficult. I can only walk very short distances and very slowly. I walk without my walker in my carpeted apartment as the soft floor absorbs the bounce and impact that my broken back and internal injuries cannot bear if I walk outside. I need my walker to stop and sit frequently. I cannot risk walking around other people as I cannot maneuver around people and my condition is too delicate for me to take the chance. Also, the injuries to my torso and both my shoulders and neck makes it very difficult for me to push a four-wheel walker. I cannot travel on public transit. I have tried and it is too dangerous and painful. I cannot hold on to handrails. There is only one seat I can sit in if in a low-floor bus. That is the first seat on the left as you enter, as that seat has a wheel well with a small railing on the cover so that I can hold my walker in front of me with my left hand, which by the way had four fingers cut by a table saw when I was 20, leaving me with very limited use of it, and I can barely lift my right arm on to that to hold on to that railing. I cannot control my right arm so I cannot let it hang down while the bus is moving. Also, I cannot lean back onto the seat as my 15 broken ribs and broken spine prevent me from leaning back on the seat. I am writing these details here for you, the reader, to be witness as to the validity that I am indeed crippled and I need a mobility scooter or specially designed wheelchair to get around. I am putting my personal lift in the public eye as I have been a public figure all through my life, from all the public businesses I have owned and operated, my political activities, the repeated times I have been in the news due to repeated acts of criminality against me by professionals. My only recourse in defense has been to write and hope that the public eyes will afford me some justice. As you may or may not know, that any published articles are admissible in any court of law. So you see, all my writings are to provide a paper trail of evidence as to what is being done to me because I refuse to break my promise to God. And for that, they now want to say that all my injuries are not real and that I need psychiatric help. Many months ago, I went to see Mark Burley of the Occupational Therapy, public as in government paid for, clinic, where he determined that I do indeed need a mobility scooter. So all medical referrals for the scooter and the confirmed documentation that I need a scooter has been provided to economical insurance. Mark Burley sent out requests for cost estimates for the four-wheel specialized scooter I need. Mark told me that I should have the scooter by the beginning of June. So I had to move to an accessible building and leave my previous apartment that was within walking distance to stores. Now I live too far from anything to go to do any shopping. Now I do not even get minimal walking exercise as there is nowhere for me to walk to. There's no sidewalk on my street and there are a lot of hills. Plus, I cannot carry anything that I cannot put into my walker. As a result of my lack of physical activity, I am now deteriorating at an accelerated pace. Also, we have public transit here for the physically challenged, and only people with disabilities and the proper forms filled out with a medical doctor will give you a pass to use it. It is called AccessiBus, so I got my pass months ago for AccessiBus in anticipation of getting my scooter, which I never got. I very recently discovered that the scooter I am supposed to get does not fit on the ramp to the access of bus, and also I just found out that I cannot possibly sit on the seat in those buses as they do not offer back support and they do not any armrests for my right arm or seat belts. I was led to believe that I would be able to ride my scooter on board, it would be tied down and I would be able to stay sitting in it. Just like they do for people in wheelchairs. Then I was told that the scooter would need to be outfitted with tie-down cue strengths. So now winter is coming and I have no mobility scooter. So I then advised Mark Burley that I will now need a wheelchair instead of a scooter, and he advised me that he would put out the necessary requests for estimates for a motorized wheelchair. Also, I mentioned to Mark that I could still use a scooter for going out and that I am not sure if with my injuries that I would be able to actually ride the scooter. I asked Mark if there was any way for me to get one for a few days to test out. He said he would do everything he can to make that possible. That was only a couple of weeks ago. Also, I have for the past 5 months had the help of an orthopedic company that makes braces. They have made 2 custom knee braces for me and 1 for my lower back and abdomen. The economical insurance that my claim for injuries is against is now ignoring all reports and findings from the physiotherapists, and they claim that I have no doctors willing to confirm that I need these braces or that I need a mobility scooter. At present, I can only travel by taxis, which cost $60 an hour. The insurance company has had to pay for my taxis for medical appointments only. They refuse to provide me with taxis for anything else. Here in Nova Scotia, we have dual automobile insurance. There is the insurance everyone buys, and with that there is the mandatory Section B no-fault insurance that is supposed to pay for anything that is medically necessary that the public health care does not provide, for up to 4 years and not to exceed $25,000. I presently live on public assistance on disability. After paying my bills, I only have about $100 for everything else. I also have to pay for taxis to go out and shop. I never have enough food. I spend about $900 a year on food, and even the government's own nutritionist says that a single man needs to spend $238 a month to eat healthy. So that adds up to $2,975. So, as you can see, I am not only crippled, imprisoned, but I am also being deliberately starved. Now are you getting the idea as to why I am writing this out publicly? The only thing extra I pay for that I cannot go without is my internet connection. I need my internet as I am trapped in my house. Without the internet, I would give up. I have no relatives here, and I only have an elderly uncle in Quebec and a brother in Toronto 1500 miles away. So as you see, I have no one to help me with anything. I have not been able to do my laundry due to both physical and financial limitations. My laundry has only been washed twice in the past 10 months. Very soon I will be in serious trouble as the snow and ice season comes. I will not be able to safely walk outside. The danger of falling could leave me paralyzed or dead. I could not even reach out with my arms to stop or cushion my fall. I need a surgeon to pin my spine before it is too late, and the local doctors will not even see me. If you are a doctor and think you may be able to render me some help, it would be appreciated. I can be contacted at thevisionary@rocketmail.com. I decided to write this update today because of an email I received from my lawyer Ronan Holland of Welton McGinnis Barristers and Solicitors, where Economical Liability Insurance Company is completely dismissing all evidence as to the facts of my health situation and needs and is refusing to pay for anything. Recently, I went out to see a pain management doctor that gave me Lyrica as a trial medication. She did not advise me as to the possible very serious complications that could develop from the use of this new drug. I went to the manufacturer's website and was totally shocked at what the doctor gave me. I was also shocked that the doctor never advised me or asked out of respect whether or not I wanted to take these risks. So I returned to the doctor 2 weeks later and told her I never took these medications and that I went to the manufacturer's website to learn about it. She made me very aware that she had never read the warnings and cared not to. I think it should be law that all doctors be forced to let the patients know about the risks, possible side effects, and especially when the medication is not the only choice. So I walked out and told her that there is one thing missing from the public health care system, and that is the care. She was really upset by this and told me that was uncalled for. I assured her that it was very called for. She then called my family doctor, who told me that she wanted an apology from me before she would let me return. I told my family doctor dr.to that I had already told the pain doctor I would not return. I told my family doctor that I felt it was very wrong for any doctor to give out drugs and show no respect for the patient by not providing the patient with the information with which I could give informed consent, the warning information that comes with the medication. So my family doctor gave me a really sick look, and he thinks that I am not intelligent enough to think for myself. The doctors around here all think they are gods. I now find myself seeking for another family doctor. And around here there is almost no doctors taking new patients. It matters not how kind and polite I am. I get treated like shit and it is all orchestrated to be deliberate. That is why I wrote the article, No More Free Healthcare in Canada, so this letter I have just written is being forwarded to my lawyer as a public letter. I have repeatedly requested of my lawyer for some meetings to deal with my case and he has never responded to my requests and has never seen me since the first day that I saw him when I signed the agreement with him that he agreed to be my lawyer in this lawsuit against this supposed old lady. Oh, another note. The laws here are written by corporate crooks on behalf of other corporations. So it has been hinted at me that if this old lady that I have never seen dies, that my claim for damages dies too. That is another fraud. She had a fully covered vehicle at the time and I did put a claim against her insurer. So whether or not she is alive does not change the fact that the insurance was valid and paid for. I recently asked my lawyer about the charge laid on the woman and whether she plead guilty or not. My lawyer said that he does not care about that and did not want to look into it or even talk about it. Does that not show that my lawyer has no intention of looking out for my best interests? That means you run in Holland. I told my lawyer in my last telephone conversation with him that my previous lawyer and the insurance company are very aware but are not acknowledging my telling them that the accident was a deliberate and professionally orchestrated attempt on my life. I also told my lawyer that I wrote the article, How to Assassinate a Cyclist, and published it online. I said to him that I am shocked that some people are allowed to assassinate people in broad daylight on a public street and in front of many witnesses. I asked him what has happened to our country and what has happened to our democracy that is supposed to be about truth, justice and liberty. He never answered me. http://danieltozy.wordpress.com http://www.twitter.com/danieltozy http://www.twitter.com/danieltozy You may also search any of my articles titled with Daniel J. Towsey in the search and you will find it at many places online. I recommend the only private search engine www.xquick.com. A Truth Soldier copyright notice. You are free to republish Truth Soldier and or Daniel J. Towsey articles in whole form only. You may take quotes from it as long as you provide a link back to the original article and you give attribution to the writer being a Truth Soldier. You are also free to print or email it in whole, only exception being corporations not allowed.